for you would be looking at the latest sell-off we've had. And we'd almost laugh at it by comparison, because what you're looking at would be a complete bludgeoning of stocks, everything else.
Yes, because, of course, everything is drastically overpriced.
How much overpriced? Even now, Dow, S&P, collectively.
All right. The S&P touched at 666
right.
At the bottom in March 2009.
I found that always very interesting, 666.
Okay. It was an interesting number. But the point is that the permanent earnings capacity at sustainable interest rates in a global market that's deflating of the S&P 500, I doubt, is $80. And $80 a share, not the 100 where it is today or the 130 that Wall Street sees coming. If you put a normal multiple on that 12 or 15 times, you get a stock market index price dramatically lower.
All right, so I'm doing the math backwards, and you're better at this as Ronald Reagan's budget director than I'll ever be. That's at least another 3,000 Dow.
I'm not talking about the Dow.
I understand that. I understand it, but to get people to get a handle on this. We still have another few thousand points.
Thousands of Dow points, hundreds of S&P points. Trillions of market cap that isn't real simply reflects the speculative mania that's being fueled.
Well, what has kept it unreal? The idea that the Fed has propped it up with low interest, and before that, all of this throwing money at it, right?
All this throwing money at it in the low interest rates. What do the gamblers on Wall Street love? That is borrowing money overnight for 5 basis points and buying anything that might be going up and taking the spread, or borrowing anything that might
have... money day.
Pardon?
It's been very easy money.
It's very easy money, but it's very unsustainable, and it's very unreal money. And it's,
well, we want to get on
top of
the
very definition of a bubble.
I understand. And you were worrying about this trillions of dollars of debt ago, but here we are now, closing on a $19 trillion. And I always think that if you were to raise taxes and cut spending in this delicate recovery now, you're going to compound the problem. You're not going to get that much more revenue, and you might make the debt situation worse. What do you say?
The answer to that is the day of reckoning has to come, and the more you
defer, I'm saying that day of reckoning makes the day of reckoning worse to reckon with.
No, the day of reckoning is going to be quite painful. The day of reckoning could lead to years of stagnation and turmoil and dislocation in our financial system, but the longer we inflate the bubble and defer the day of reckoning, the worse the ultimate end game is
going to
be.
What you're talking about sounds like making 2009 a party by comparison.
I think, sure. And they said in 2007, it's a Goldilocks economy, don't worry. And the next thing we knew, $14 trillion of market
cap disappeared.
Do you
like real estate? Or still real estate is a crapshoot?
You know, real estate that has income-producing capability is probably a worthwhile investment. But most real estate,
what about gold,
if it's traded,
silver,
it's,
platinum,
it's,
any of that
stuff? When the monetary system breaks down, gold will be the monetary asset.
Well, where do you put your money? Where do you put your money?
I think the safest place for money right now is in short-term instruments and cash, because we're in a global deflationary crisis, and in a deflation, cash is king. And when this big reset, when this big adjustment happens, those that have dry powder, those that have kept themselves in cash and not rolled the dice in the casino, will have wonderful opportunities to buy great things, including Apple that you were talking
about. Yeah, what does that say about consumers are quite happy to spend hundreds of dollars, even with this lease program on these phones? But they're leasing phones.
Yeah, well, the point is that's one product, but whatever life there is in the consumer sector right now on the margin is being kept alive by subprime auto loans or leased phones all the rest of it. There is no surplus discretionary income available in our economy because, as I said, $14 trillion of household debt, or 13 and a half, I should say, is a lot of debt that's holding down the capacity of the economy to expand. But we incurred that debt over the last 20 years.
What do you think Ronald Reagan, your boss, would say? Yeah. You were famously brought to the woodshed for bemoaning these deficits and the debt that was beginning to pile up. What do you think he would say looking at the conditions now?
Well, he might say, I told you so, because he actually did worry that you can't build an economy on debt, that the whole Keynesian magic of just getting people to borrow and spend, whether it's government or
which was the inspiration on the 86 Tax Act to address some of this, right?
Yeah.
Not enough to your liking.
Not enough, but it at least leveled the playing field.
So you think he'd look at this and say, hey, get serious?
Yeah, because the one great thing about him was he was anti-Keynesian to the core. He got educated in the 1920s before Keynes even invented you know, all the malarkey that came out of the mid-1930s. So I think he would be shocked at the way this has turned out. And probably on his watch, if he had really known what was going on, it never would have happened. Because he shouldn't have appointed Greenspan as chairman of the Fed. Greenspan turned out to be the greatest money printer in history.
But remember, up to that Greenspan point. Came in August 1987. Just a couple of months later, we had the October crash.
Yeah, but what did he do? He then panicked, found the printing press in the basement of the Eccles building, and started running that thing at higher
speeds.
Which
is what Ben Bernanke essentially did.
For the next 19 years, he handed it off to Bernanke, and Bernanke handed it off to Yellen. And we now have a Fed with a balance sheet that's staggering in size, $4.5 trillion. When Greenspan got there, you know how big it was? $200 billion. In other words, it's up 22 times in that short span of Greenspan, Bernanke, Yellen. All that printed money just created artificial bubbles and artificial financial values in our economy.
I know your views, personal views on this, but do you think the market sells off if by the end of the year the Fed doesn't hike interest rates? Because it's been so telegraphed and warned.
I think we're nearing the end of the Fed's credibility. I think even some of the adults on the Fed board, if there are any, are starting to worry about the absurdity of 80 months of zero interest rates on the grounds it's an emergency. When the when the number they believe in, the unemployment rate, is at 5.1%. And that happens to be in the lowest 18% of observations for the last 45 years. In other words, we've had 535 job reports, monthly job reports, since 1970. And only in 18% of them was the unemployment rate at 5.1 or
that
lower.
That used to be considered full employment.
So,
remember, you would
this is my point. This
full
is
employment
my point.
Was 5%.
How in the world can they justify zero interest rates at full employment by their lights?
All right. Well, you put us all in a great mood.
Okay.
If you have sharp instruments at home, you might want to take them out. We're going to debate exactly what Mr. Stockman was saying. And it's not coincidental that he has that beard. He hides himself from people who know him when he leaves on the street. But one of the smartest minds I know.